Good morning, everyone, and welcome to Copplestone Methodist Church on this fourth Sunday of Advent, where we gather together with joy in our hearts as we remember the birth of Jesus at Bethlehem. Our speaker this morning is Matt Yendall. Matt, we do welcome you home. Matt grew up in our church, and it's lovely to have him with us today. The worship this morning is being led by Naina. Naina, thank you for leading us in this way this morning. I would like to give all of you a special invitation to join us again later today at 4:30 this afternoon, or as soon after that as you're able, so that you can share in our carol service. Christmas may be a bit different this year due to COVID. At least the celebrations may be different, but the message is the same. The message of God made man in Palestine nearly 2,000 years ago, and whose birth we celebrate with such joy in our hearts today. We'd like you to join us too, if possible, on Christmas Day, when we're having a service at 11 o'clock in the morning. It's going to be led by our youth leader, Mark, with Becky. And we do trust that you will be able to share our celebrations in that way. So before I hand over to Naina, let us pray. Father, we come to you this morning with such joy in our hearts as we meditate afresh on the wonder of your entering into our world as a babe in Bethlehem, growing up to become the saviour of mankind. Father, we come with joy, with gladness, with gratitude. We pray that you will open the eyes of our hearts, that we may see fresh and new wonders in what you have done for us. In the name of Jesus, our Saviour. Amen.
happy Christmas. It's crazy to think it's the last Sunday before Christmas and we're nearly at the end of 2020, and what a year it's been, hasn't it? A little bit not what any of us would have expected, I'm sure, but as a church we just want to wish you all a happy Christmas and a peaceful and hopefully COVID-free 2021. Now this morning Matt's speaking to us, and we've got Martin doing some prayers and Sean speaking to the children, and later on Matt's speaking about worth. And it got me thinking what that word really means. And I just want to show you something that we've had probably since Matt was probably about 2 or 3, so 22, 23 years. And I'm just going to get him to pan around and show you our little nativity scene. Now, hopefully you can all see that. And we've got Mary here, and baby Jesus, and Joseph, and various different figures in that nativity scene. And I wanted to talk to you about the worth of that. Now, you've probably seen it's homemade. It's a bit rickety. We've had it a long time. One of the figures even here, let me just show you. This poor king, he is headless. But this nativity scene is worth a lot to us as a family because of who it was given by, of who it was made by, and because of all the memories that we have. So this nativity was given to us by my Auntie Glad, like I say, when the boys were very, very small. And Auntie Glad was somebody very special to us, and she's no longer here. So whenever we get this out every Christmas, we automatically think about her, talk about her, some of the funny things that she used to do when we played cards, and it gives us some really lovely memories. The other thing about it is it was made by somebody special. It was made by Dennis Burton, our minister, who sadly was taken from us. It was made by his dad. He actually made the whole thing, crafted all the figures and painted them. So there's a memory in there of somebody that was very special to us. And lastly, it holds lots of Christmas memories for us. This was something that when Matt was very small, and really until he went to uni, this was his job. Every year, Matt was set up the nativity. And the first Christmas he was at uni, he wasn't home early enough to do it. And so myself, I've done it, Dan's done it. And this year, for the first time, Phil's done it. But every year we get it out, it causes us to think back over many Christmases. And I just wanted to talk to you about the fact that this thing monetary-wise is worth very little. In fact, probably nothing. But because of who gave it, because of who made it, and because of the memories, it's worth a great deal to us as a family. And as Matt speaks later, I just want you to think about what that means for you in terms of God, in terms of that he made you, that he's your saviour, that he came to earth that first Christmas, so that you could know him and have a relationship with him. So I hope you enjoy the rest of this service. It's amazing to be with you again this morning. And I'm going to hand over to Martin now as we pray.
I'm sure you've heard of the supposed Chinese curse, may you live in interesting times. We certainly are living in interesting and confusing times, and everything is changing. In the interval between my recording of these prayers and the service being broadcast, much might have changed for Brexit and for COVID-19. Decisions have to be made. It will affect the lives of millions, some of them life and death decisions. How do we compare the value, the worth, of the lives of the elderly with the livelihood and well-being of other people, or the health of our children? So many impossible choices. And so I turn to a verse from my favourite carol. And ye beneath life's crushing load, whose forms are bending low, who toil along the climbing way with painful steps and slow, look now, for glad and golden hours come swiftly on the wing. O rest beside the weary road and hear the angels sing. Christmas reminds us of God's promise through Isaiah, that in returning and rest you shall be saved, in quietness and in trust shall be your strength. So, let us pray. Father God, as Christmas approaches, we are reminded again of the wonder and greatness of your love, that you value us so highly that you sent your Son to be our Saviour. We remember too that you worked out your love through the lowly and the humble, shepherds, a carpenter, a village girl, and not the high and mighty. Whoever we may be, we are so precious in your sight, and we praise and glorify you. Lord, accept our praises. Father, we lift to you those in government grappling with what can seem to be impossible decisions as they try to keep us healthy and preserve our national life. We pray that they will make time to contemplate the birth of your Son, that they will draw strength from the child in the manger who is Lord of the universe, and that they will be changed to see the world as you do, truly to value the poor, the weak, the marginalised. Then, Lord, we pray for the decisions to be made, for Brexit, for COVID restrictions, for the economy. May they reflect and carry out your purposes. Lord, hear our prayers. Father, others too face seemingly impossible decisions. Doctors and nurses already exhausted, businesses confused by Brexit and hammered by COVID, schools struggling to cope, and many others. The angels of the carols can seem very remote for those who are struggling, Lord, but we pray that they will see the Holy Child and know that you are indeed here in our midst, that you care for them and for the problems they are faced with, and in that knowledge, may they find strength and encouragement. Lord, hear our prayers. Lord God, in this Christmas season, we thank you for our families. We see the Holy Family and rejoice in the love that filled that stable. And we thank you for those who are dear to us, parents, children, grandparents, grandchildren, brothers, sisters, partners, and all the rest. It's perhaps true that the COVID restrictions have helped us realise how much we value and are blessed by people whom we might otherwise take for granted. Lord, accept our thanks. Finally, Lord, we pray for all those who will struggle this Christmas, perhaps feeling that they have been overlooked and are not valued. Families struggling to feed their children, the sick and bereaved, those anxious about housing and employment. Father, we place them in your loving arms, praying that you would hold them close as Mary held Jesus. And we pray that you would help us to do likewise in whatever way we can. Lord, hear our prayers. Almighty God, as we prepare with joy to celebrate the gift of the Christ child, embrace the earth with your glory, and be for us a living hope in Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Thank you.
Good morning, and I want to talk to Kids Zone this morning and the grid, well, anyone really who's willing to listen. And I've got my brother's godmother. She works or used to work for an auction house. And if you don't know what an auction house is, it's a place that sells lots of different stuff. And often they can sell paintings and antiques and things like that. And a job working for an auction house, one of their jobs is a valuer. And basically what a valuer does is they look at different things and they work out what they think it's worth and how much money they think it could be sold for. So they might look at a painting and say, oh, it's a really nice painting. It's got a really nice frame and it was painted by a famous artist. So I think it's worth £1,000. That's the kind of thing a valuer does. And this morning, I want to see how good you are at valuing things. So I've got some items here with me this morning, and I'm going to hold them up, or I've got some pictures of them as well that I'll hold up that hopefully you can see. And I want you to have a little think, and you can, if you're with people this morning, if you're in a house full of people, hopefully not too full of people, but I want you to have a bit of a competition, perhaps who can get the price the closest. If you want to comment below in the YouTube comments, feel free to do that. There's no prizes or anything though, so don't get too excited. And just see how good you are at valuing stuff. Okay, so let's start with, I've got this. This is a cookbook. This is Jamie's Great Britain. It was in 2011 that one there came out. How much do you think this cookbook was worth when it was new. What do you think that cost? Hardback, good quality, British cooking. Give you a few seconds to fight about it. And I can tell you that that book apparently cost £30 when it was new. £30 for Jamie's Great Britain. What about this one? What about a bag? This is a bag of caster sugar. Sainsbury's bag of caster sugar. What sort of money do you think that would be? Have a little guess. And I can tell you that the caster sugar was £1.60, which is fine, seems quite reasonable. Let's mix it up. I'll show you a picture on screen now. And you tell me what you think, what you think that one there's worth. So it's a Lamborghini Hurricane, that's 5.2 V10. And this is actually for sale on eBay right now. And the price of this one is, the asking price is £189,000, which seems reasonable. What about this one? What about that? A Big Mac meal. So that's your Big Mac, that's your drink, and some fries. Not large, just the regular. Price on that? Anyone know? I'm sure some of you do. It's £4.69. I don't know how you're doing. I'm sure you're probably doing quite well because you're probably familiar with a lot of these things. I've got one here. This is, I have had a bite out of it. This is one of Nicola's homemade mince pies, homemade mincemeat with like a macaroon top with almonds. It's absolutely lovely. I'll show it that way because it looks nicer. But what do you think for a half-eaten homemade mince pie made by my very culinary skilled wife? How much do you think for that one? What would you value that at? Well, I can tell you from experience of eating it, I would value that for that half, that would be £45. And I think that would be reasonable. So it tastes amazing. Just a couple more now. Find them. What about this one? This was a toy in 1975. It was called the Pet Rock. And this was a real toy that you could buy. And it was a stone in a box with some straw surrounding it. And it was encouraging people to treat it like a pet. What do you think people would pay for that one? Well, I can tell you they paid £3.95. for that back in 1975. So I don't know, obviously people had too much money in 1975. Nearly there. This one here, this is the wig. We're looking at the wig. So a presidential wig. What would you be willing to pay for that? How much do you think it's worth? This is still for sale at the moment. You can buy these on the internet. And you can buy that one for £12.09 to get that great look. Right, last one, another old one, about some secondhand trainers. You can see, these are actually Nike Air Jordans. They are used, so the value is not quite as high, I imagine, as it would normally be. Nike Air Jordan trainers, what do you think you'd pay for a secondhand pair of those? Well, I can tell you that these particular pair of trainers sold for £455,945 for these trainers. And I don't imagine you put a figure like that down. You probably weren't thinking that sort of money for these shoes. And neither would I be. But the thing is with these shoes is they're more than just a pair of trainers. Well, they're not more than a pair of trainers. They are just a pair of trainers. They haven't got any... They can't make you fly. They haven't got any amazing capability. They don't make you run faster. They're probably fairly comfy, but they are quite old now, 35 years old. But these shoes were worn by Michael Jordan. And this was the first Air Jordans to be worn by Michael Jordan. Michael Jordan was the world's greatest basketballer and really, really famous in America, and he was quite famous over here as well. And the reason these shoes are so valuable is because they used to belong to Michael Jordan. You see, nothing in the shoe itself is particularly special. They might look quite nice, they might be quite comfortable, but they're just a shoe. And I think new, they cost about £80. But because Michael Jordan owned them, it made them so much more valuable. And I want to read you a verse from the Bible. I'm actually going to read you two. The first one is from Romans 14. It says this. It says, if we live, we live to the Lord. If we die, we die to the Lord. So then, whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. And then another verse in Psalm 100, it says, know that the Lord, he is good. It is he who made us, and we are his. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Now, you know, when I'm a Christian and when I asked Jesus into my life, when I became a Christian, I was making a choice to follow Jesus. But in doing that, I was also saying, Jesus, I belong to you. I want to join your family. And the reason I made that decision, the reason I did that is because God loved me so much that he gave his son to die for me. He valued me so much that he was willing to give his son to die, which is amazing. And he values you just the same. He values us all. He sees that we are so we are worth so much to him, he was willing to let his son die to save us. And this morning, you might feel a little bit worthless. You might feel you're not very good at stuff. You might feel you're not very good at school, or you're not great at making friends, or you're perhaps not the best footballer in your class, or you know, you're not the tallest or the strongest or whatever it is. We sometimes feel like a little bit worthless, don't we? But you know, God loves you so much that he gave his son to die for you. And your worth is not in what you can do, how good you are at stuff, how many skills you've got in different areas. Your worth is about who you belong to. You see, someone once said, it's not about who you are, but about whose you are. And you know, I belong to Jesus, and I feel that he values me just like he values you. And I would encourage you this morning, however you're feeling, know that God values you so highly. You are his prized possession. You are priceless. You're like those trainers that perhaps we don't always look that great. Perhaps we're not the most amazingly skilled person in the world. Perhaps we don't have the greatest gifts. Perhaps there are people that are better than us in lots of different areas of our life. But you know what? God made you the way you are, and he loves you the way you are, and he thinks you are absolutely priceless. So remember that this morning. I'm going to pray, and then I'm going to hand over. So let's just close our eyes and take a second to pray. Father God, we thank you, Lord, that you value us, that to you, Lord, we are worth something. We are worth everything, in fact, to you, so much so that you gave your son to die for us. And we thank you for that, Lord. And we just pray that you would remind us when we're perhaps feeling down, that you would remind us, Lord, that we have worth in you, and that it's not about who we are and what we can do, but it's about whose we are. It's about belonging to Jesus. So we thank you, Lord, and we praise you. Amen.
Today's reading is taken from Luke chapter 1, verses 26 to 38, and is entitled, A Virgin Conceives. In the sixth month of Elizabeth's pregnancy, God sent the angel Gabriel to the Galilean village of Nazareth to a virgin engaged to be married to a man descended from David. His name was Joseph, and the virgin's name Mary. Upon entering, Gabriel greeted her. Good morning. You're beautiful with God's beauty, beautiful inside and out. God be with you. She was thoroughly shaken, wondering what was behind a greeting like that. But the angel assured her, Mary, you have nothing to fear. God has a surprise for you. You will become pregnant and give birth to a son and call his name Jesus. He will be great, be called Son of the Highest. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David. He will rule Jacob's house forever, no end ever to his kingdom. Mary said to the angel, But how? I've never slept with a man. The angel answered, The Holy Spirit will come upon you, the power of the highest hover over you. Therefore, the child you bring to birth will be called Holy, Son of God. And did you know that your cousin Elizabeth conceived a son, old as she is? Everyone called her barren, but here she is, 6 months pregnant. Nothing, you see, is impossible with God. And Mary said, Yes, I see it all now. I'm the Lord's maid, ready to serve. Let it be with me, just as you say. Then the angel left her.
Good morning, everyone. On this, the last Sunday before Christmas. If you're one of those people who leaves all your shopping to the last minute, I wish you well on your quest to get all your Christmas shopping done. Typically, you would, myself and Dan and Grandad, used to go into town on Christmas Eve. It was a little tradition we had, hopelessly wandering around trying to get Granny a Christmas present. And it was interesting because you would always see that one guy, and typically it is blokes, I'm sorry, who would have about 10 shopping bags in either arm, his hands red raw from carrying the bags. But key to it all was a Greg's festive bake that he was eating whilst holding his shopping bags because he didn't have time to stop. But in Granddad's defence, he has got a lot better. And I don't think that this year we will be heading into Exeter on Christmas Eve. But let me tell you how excited I am to be coming home and seeing all my family. It's been a bit strange being being across the bridge and not being able to see family. And although I'm recording this in Wales, I'm in my flat, I've got my Christmas tree here, I've got my sack of presents, and I've got my lovely log fire burning. When you guys see this, I will be back in Devon. I've got one more week of school left and the kids aren't in, so it should be really, really nice. And I am super excited to be sharing with you guys this morning, albeit a little bit differently, but I really feel like this is a message that God has been speaking to me about, and I believe that he's laid it on my heart to share with you guys this morning. Before we start, I'd just like to say a massive thank you for the love, support and encouragement that I get continually from my Copplestone Church family. It is hugely important to me and it has helped me massively on my journey of faith up to this point and continuing journey of faith. So thank you all for that. So I'm just going to pray and then we'll dive straight into it. Dear God, I thank you for the opportunity to be able to share this morning. I thank you for this time of year. I hope and pray that this year, more than ever, we will have such a precious time with our family and our loved ones, and we will just know what's important to us this Christmas. Help us to not lose sight of the reason for this season. And I just really pray that we will know your love this morning. Amen. Great. Now, it's Christmas, but not maybe quite how we would normally celebrate it. And for lots of us, it's fair to say it's been a bit of a topsy-turvy year. But I think in the midst of all that has gone on, we still have so much to be thankful for. But that might sound a bit confusing. You might at this point feel restricted. You might feel tired. You might feel like you're just trying to tick boxes before you break for work for Christmas. And more so than ever, I think, people are asking the big questions. The big questions about where their security comes from, where their affirmation comes from, and where their certainty comes from in a year that has been completely up in the air. But I think this year, the Christmas story points us perfectly towards the answer. Now, at Christmas time as a family, we like to play board games and do quizzes. I'm sure every single one of you listening has done some form of online quiz. Who even knew what Zoom was at the start of the year? But there's one type of quiz, I think it's a TV show as well, that where you get a selection of questions or statements, and you have to try and find the link between all those five statements, say for example. I have to be honest, I'm absolutely terrible at it, but we're going to do a little quiz now and we're going to see if you guys can work it out. So the first one is a present, the second one is a kind message from someone, the third is someone making you dinner, and the fourth is a Bible verse. So what is the link between those four things? I'll give you a little bit of a minute. See, to me, all those four things have worth. If someone buys you a present, it costs them a price. If someone writes you a kind message, it's worth something to you. If someone makes you dinner, that act of service is worth something. They've given up their time to do that for you. And when we read the Bible, it speaks truth over the worth we have in God. I could have listed a whole host of things, because we all put value in different things. The other day I was watching The Apprentice, I quite like it, and it was a selling task. They had been given a garage full of antiques, the sort of thing you'd find in your garage or your great-great auntie's house, and they had to try and sell these items for the highest price, or just get rid of them as quickly as they could. And one group had a product, it was like this vase thing, and they sold it for £5. When they actually got it back and got it was valued at £200. And that's what I want to speak about today, and that is worth, and in particular, our self-worth. I think this is massively important, because the way we view ourselves has a huge effect on our whole lives, our family, relationships, our friends, our work. And sometimes we can view ourselves as only being able to be worth so much, when in truth, we are worth so much more. The story of Jesus' birth is one that is repeated every year for obvious reasons. It's the whole reason for Christmas. But what has struck me more than ever this year is the part that Mary played in it. And I don't think she gets enough credit. We read the accounts of Jesus' birth in the Gospels of Matthew and Luke, but the part of the story that we're going to look at today and that was read to us earlier is found in Luke, when Mary finds out she is going to carry the Saviour of the world. And this can be found in Luke 1, 26 through to 38. So a bit of background. Mary is pledged to be married to Joseph. She's probably pretty content with life. She's going to have a lovely new husband, and they're going to live a happy life together. When all of a sudden, out of absolutely nowhere, an angel appears to her and completely flips her world upside down. And maybe for some of us this year, we have felt like that, that our world has been completely turned upside down. Situations may have happened. Obviously, everything that's been going on in the world, just our lives have been completely thrown. Now, I don't know about you, but if an angel appeared to me in my bed, I would be pretty terrified and scared. And then the angel says, "Greetings, you who are highly favoured, the Lord is with you." And Mary's reaction was that of someone who was troubled and shocked. And in the Message version of the passage, it says she was thoroughly shaken, which I think is putting it a little bit lightly. She wasn't sure what to make of it, and was rightly a bit confused as to what had happened, and described it as a greeting. And that maybe isn't the most helpful word. Maybe a better word would be account. How did she account for what had just happened? Is this a dream? Am I seeing things? Have I fallen over? Surely there's no truth in this. There's no way that I've been chosen to carry the Saviour of the world. And she starts to think, she starts to process what's happened. And she starts to think practically and says, "How will this be since I'm a virgin?" But the angel replies and says, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you." And I think it's at this point, for the first time in history, that someone understands their worth in God. Mary understands how much she is worth to God, and maybe she was the first person of faith to do that. From then on in the story, we know that Joseph stays with Mary, they follow, they travel to Bethlehem, and the Saviour of the world is born. But the point I'm trying to focus on is that Mary understood her worth. I think so often in our lives, We can react how Mary originally did, troubled and shocked, not thinking we were qualified or enough. In a world of online and ever-present, we can look at ourselves believing we are worth nothing because of what someone else might say on the internet, or say in person, or a comment. Often, society shapes our perspective, and we compare ourselves to others in different ways. It may be a situation in work or where we are with our jobs, we might think we're not doing so well. It might be the way we look at ourselves, we might not think we're pretty enough, or we're not athletic enough. We might be unhappy with our relationship status or our friendship status. We might not think that we're particularly popular. We just might not think we're good enough. And all those things can affect our self-worth. And what I think the story of Mary tells us is that we have a God who finds worth in every single one of us. And he used Mary, an unknown, to bring in the most precious gift of all, Jesus. She would have faced backlash from people. And if that had been nowadays, more than likely she would have been judged on social media, maybe trolls or all those different things. There would have been negative comments. But Mary didn't care. She knew where she found her worth, and that was in God. And I wonder this morning, do you know where your worth comes from? We live in a world full of comparison and judgment, and I see it all the time in school, but it's with all of us as well. And it can be hard sometimes to have a good opinion of ourselves. Over lockdown, school's closed, so I came back to Devon, and as lovely as it was being home with my family, seeing my friends, it was a real wake-up call to me, and I lost sight of my worth in God. And I felt that everything was going against me and that my life wasn't good enough and I wasn't where I should be. And one day I was driving back from milking the cows and I was listening to a song on my phone, and there's a verse in this song that says this: "To love me at my worst, and even when I don't remember, you remind me of my worth." And I just broke down because it completely hit me how much God loves me, how much I'm worth to him. Christmas is a time of gifts, love, and quality time together with family and friends, albeit a little bit different this year. But I want every single one of us this year to know our worth and to know that we are loved by God. And I think there are three practical gifts that maybe we can do to help each other know that this year, that we can give and receive. And my first idea is to text or tell someone how much you love, value and appreciate them. Often this can mean so much more than it seems on the surface, because to someone else, you are worth thinking about, and you are, that person was worth you taking the time out of their day, because let's be honest, it doesn't take very long, to send a text message to tell them that you love them. My second gift idea that I think you can give this year is to show someone how much they're worth to you. And this might be through an act of kindness. It might be through washing the dishes, doing the hoovering, making someone a meal. That all those things are great, but they're all worth so much more. It shows that person that you are prepared to give up time. You're prepared to recognize them and to do something for them. And thirdly, get into the Bible. If you don't have a Bible, I'd love to buy you one. I think it's the most important life-giving thing that we can have. But get into your Bible and read John 3:16, because this shows God's love for you. And when we give time to God, it shows how much worth we place on our faith. So this Christmas, I hope you have an amazing time. I hope it's the best one yet. But the most important thing I want you to know is that you are worth it all to a God who sent his son down in the form of a baby to give it all for you. Amen. Dear God, I thank you for this morning, and I pray that you will just help us to know that we are worth so much to you, and not to listen to what other people say, but to know and get our security from you. Amen. Great, so that is the end of my talk. It is now time for our final song. Our final song has been picked by me. It's a song that reminds me of Christmas at Copplestone. It reminds me of the fake oranges and the smell they bring off of the Christmas tree. It reminds me of the kids on the stage giving off their presents and their excited faces. So yeah, our final song today is Come and Join the Celebration.
It for our service today. In a moment we're gonna see some familiar faces, so don't turn off until the end of the service, because it'd be really good to see so many of our church family. Later on we've got our carol service at 4:30, so tune in for that. There's going to be some live action for the first time from Copplestone Methodist Church, so I'm really excited to see that, so do tune in then if you can. And at 11 o'clock on Christmas Day as well, we invite you just to join us for a really short time to reflect on the reason that we are celebrating. But as we close this service and as we think about Christmas coming on Friday, we just want to say to you as a church that we miss you, that we love you, and that we just pray for you and trust that this Christmas, with all its restrictions and slightly weirdness, will still be amazing, will still give you an opportunity to pause and think about the reason that we celebrate. Thank you and God bless.
Christmas night, be born in me. secret song of how that star lit up the sky, and how this world lost in the darkness felt the hope of heaven's light. Open my eyes, oh heart, believe.
Shine, shine.